Why are you invading my space?
I can't tell you. Is this okay?
No.
Toward me.
You can sit right there.
I'm learning. Haven't you? Dreams come true!
What's up, everybody? Alright, I'm done eating. I'm tired. Hey! Let's do the show! Let's do the thing! And stop! Okay. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Honesty Hour. I'm going to answer some questions.
Woo!
And we're going to get to know each other a little bit better. Oh, fuck.
Money.
It looks like they forgot to turn all of the notifications on despite me yelling at them twice to do so. Emily? I blame Emily. Because I told her to turn them on. It's been a real shit show this week, but we're going to fix it by next week. I promise you. Or I will bust heads. Alright, guys. Alright, so. Let's open up Discord and see what kind of questions came in. How you guys doing? How's your week? It's been a pretty eventful one so far. It's been a crazy night for Minker. Hey, Gorstag! Thank you for that. Thank you for that. 6 months. Blame PAX Prime, right? Blame PAX Prime. PAX has been the bane of our existence despite it being over. Alright. Thanks again for a great Monday holiday stream. Much fun, says Zinblade. It was a good time, you know? It was pretty good. Alright, Emily got it fixed. Thanks, Emily. Ozai75 is pretty good. I'm alright. Rossasan, just passed by to say the shows at the channel are great and nice interview at PAX. Oh, Rossasan, thank you for that. Which interview did you see, by the way? Okay, so I'm sure all of you guys in the chat room know what this is about, what we do on this show. Sometimes it's with the guests, tonight it is not. I'm going to be answering you guys questions that you left me in Discord, questions that you asked in the chat. Things might get real, they might not, we'll see how things go. Our chance, okay, so here's how I look at it. For better or worse, you all are investors in this channel. And this is my report to you. Our once a week little sit down. Where we get to have a conversation, I tell you what we're planning on doing with the channel, how things have been going. So you get to see a little bit behind the scenes of how this all works and have a better understanding of the complications that may arise, things that we're working on, and let you know that your investment is in good hands. Basically, that's the idea. And tonight we're going to listen to some Emiliana Torini and some Chelsea Wolf because fuck it. Russison, great. I'm glad you watched that. Thank you for tuning in. Dude, I do not want a Swedish Fish Oreo. Oh my god. They're poison.
They are in front of me. I was like, fuck no.
They're literally poison. After eating two, my throat burned. It literally burned. We gotta glue that down. It smells like acetone. It actually smells like acetone. Are you seriously? It's gonna burn your throat, dude. I think they're poison. I think they're gonna like... poison. Get out of here. Get off. Get off. Trying to have a conversation with the chat room. Tired of distractions. All right. Let's go to that Honesty Hour room. I gotta find it. Looking for near. Here we go. All right, let's see some questions that came in this week. We're just gonna go through the list here. The first question from Vic the Bitter. Have you had a good week? Pretty good. It's been an interesting week already. So we started off, as you guys know, with the barbecue stream right off the bat. And from that, we went right into Vanquish, and we somehow got locked hero player for a little bit, unbeknownst to us that that was gonna happen. Had I known that was gonna happen, I might have worked a little bit harder to prepare that episode. I was super stressed from PAX. We were really behind. I haven't rested in a while, which is par for the course, but usually I spend a little bit more time prepping for Vanquish just to have more variables that I can throw in a need-to moment. And then when I found out we were on locked hero player, it was kind of like, oh, fuck. So we didn't retain as well as we wanted. We did get a lot of followers, but not many like conversions over to subscribers. That being said, we did get some new community members out of that that have already stuck around and been great additions to the show. So, you know, it's what happens. And then obviously, as you guys know, we had Matt here yesterday for the Gauntlet, which was our first episode of season one. There's already some things that we've fixed since last night. There are things that, like, right when we went live, I was like, oh, fuck. Zach works as hard for Hyper RPG as I do on Claudia's channel, in my opinion. You know, Inminker, it's not always about you, bro. It's not always about you, bro. Neat way of spinning it around, but it's not always. Krund was enough. Krund was great. Krund is love. Krund is life. is there any chance you could show artists' songs during wait screens between shows? The songs are usually OC remix, so I don't know if we could do that. As far as like stuff to play?
Yeah.
Oh, QQ said if you have songs you want her to play, she'll play them in between. Is if they? Yeah. Well, the rights is a big thing. Okay, so the week's been pretty good. I mean, yesterday, Necropolis, you know, was interesting. Not as many people were searching for the game as we thought. We're gonna keep adding more sound effects to the Gauntlet, more graphics. I wanna make like a death graphic. It might say you're dead though, just to celebrate that first episode. And then, there's some of the on-screen stuff wasn't the way I wanted it. I worked on those graphics for a while, but we didn't get stuff, just got confused right when the show started. And I wanted there to be the white won't show up on screen. We'll have all the white fixed basically. It'll flow together better next week. We won't have any white on screen that isn't text, so there won't be the boxes and everything like that. So We'll keep making it better. We're gonna keep making it better. I have to say, I enjoyed the revamp of Gauntlet from how it started. It was pretty iffy show for me. Well, DZ Citroni, I hope that you guys realize by now that when we premiere a show, we work really hard to make it better every single week, and we have a plan in store. And like we said, we were playtesting a lot. And I always knew in the long run, and Rai and I knew, eventually we're gonna get to a point where we had graphics, we had sound effects, and we still have more sound effects to add. When Alex comes up here sometime this month, we're gonna work on getting better sound effects for that show. And actually like make the game show kind of part, keep adding and adding to everything. So that's how we do things here. You do your playtesting, and then things get refined, which sucks because a lot of people will tune in for something when it first starts and then make their judgment calls. And then they'll be like, I don't like it anymore. The premise feels sound, says Raya. And there's still some things we're gonna change. And there's actually a question on here that we'll address that has to do directly with that. So, let me get back to my questions here. So, KF Joser asked, the Mercer effect and getting value on rotation may have skewed things, but I was curious how listing the shows as D&D has worked out. Actually, that helped even before Mercer and Vanquished on Front Page. We found about a couple weeks ago that if we put all of our RPGs under D&D, we'd get more random viewers tuning in. Because it's a category that people search, where they don't search Shadowrun and they don't search Battletech. But that is a conversation I had at PAX with Twitch, and I can't say much because of NDAs, but I can say that things will be getting better for us in the near future, hopefully sooner rather than later. So that is something that's being worked on. They've been taking a lot of feedback from us, and I was happy with my meeting at Twitch over the weekend. So that's good news. Spatha08, actually, that's purposeful because it's called balance. If the potions happened really fast, the game would become unbalanced. It's actually something I talked to Mercer about after the show, that the game is pretty balanced right now because the time it takes for the message and the time it takes to drink the potion. What's up, 3Legit? That creates a balance, whereas if you didn't have that and you were just immediately rewarded a super powerful thing like double damage and double movement, it would make you super OP. So it is a good balance. It allows you to be powered up, but you're losing little time for being powered up. So it evens itself out. Do you feel like Twitch is going to overpromise and underdeliver again, or do you feel like they'll actually follow through? Half and half. I don't get my hopes up too high, so I kind of take like half of it at face value. So, I kind of like them back and forth. Okay. PAX. This is from Negiyama. PAX. How much, did it strain broadcasting? You've previously said that Gen Con didn't have great returns and the cost of going. Was PAX better being local? Yes. Oh wow, thank you, Draconis. You should tweet that. Please tweet that, tagging Catalyst Games and Valiant. Please do that. So, PAX was great because we didn't have to spend money to be there. Ashujin, thank you for that follow. Very much appreciated. Thank you for that. And as always, guys, on this show, every subscriber, I will have to dance very awkwardly for you. I dance on the internet for money. It's weird. And every donation, we will be extremely grateful because that keeps this channel alive. So thank you. So PAX was great. We didn't have to have a booth, so it didn't cost us anything, which I will not let us do again. I promise you guys, we will not be wasting any more money by having booths at cons. It's very expensive and it doesn't turn out for us. So all cons going forward, we have to either be paid to be there or they're local. So we have TwitchCon coming up, and we have New York City Comic Con coming up, and we are paid to be at both of those, so it justifies the us being there for exposure. Otherwise, we won't do it. So on the note of PAX, Negiyama, it was a win on a lot of ways. I got to get a lot of people's cards, start a lot of great conversations, met with a lot of good streamers, and just continuing broadening our network. So yes, success. All right. Cave Joser, and if PAX did have better returns, are there ways Thumpers can help you get into other cons? I don't think there's ways that you guys can help us get into other cons. That's usually business deals on my end. But us continuing... What's up, Blast Ronin? Thank you for that follow. Very much appreciated. Us continuing to grow our fan base will help in the long run as well. Okay. Krillin asks, if... Horror of horrors, Hyper does not start to be in the black in the next few months. Does the channel just end, or are there funding options that might come about? Small business loans. Jordan having enough faith that it will get there with more time. Okay, so, for one, it's not gonna happen. Like, this channel is mine, in the sense of, I will not let it die. And I know some people have expressed fear in the past, like, oh, I left GNS. Thank you, Trogath. They've expressed in the past, like, oh, you left GNS, are you going to leave this one if it doesn't work or if it becomes profitable? No, because this is my company. I'm the CEO, so I will not be leaving. We take pride in this. It's ours. What it will do, if it's, you know, it's like, it's not like, hey, it succeeds, it's on its own, I don't have to be here anymore. It's gonna be, hey, it succeeds, now we get to do bigger and cooler shit that we come up with this, which is crazy. So we have no one holding us back but ourselves. So if it starts to fail, I don't think there's any such thing as failing. In a super hypothetical situation, say if we weren't in the black in a couple months and we had to have a hard conversation with the community, what we wouldn't end. The channel wouldn't disappear. We would scale. We would scale back to put us in the black and then build up again. That's how we would do it, because we're in a position where we could do that technically if we had to, and we could probably do it without cutting any of our big shows. We just have to lose some of the smaller stuff, which isn't anything we want to do. We love all of our hosts, and that's like the worst come situation possible. So that is the absolute worst situation, and we're not going to let that happen. But the channel's not going to go anywhere. It's not just going to disappear or anything like that. We'll make it happen. Right, Chum Chum Jim, that's really expensive. Like, that's the kind of shit, like, if we get really big, fuck it, let's go for it. I'm all down. All down for it. Does this channel have multiple revenue streams, like shirts, like Phil DeFranco does? We do have a shirt. We have a shirt on Teespring right now that you can go pick up. It's for our Valiant show. Let's see, the Hyperpocalypse, but that's not gonna have it, yeah. Let's see, there you go, there's the shirt. And, good news, guys, so today, I know that we've been talking about starting a merch store, and we have you guys in the community helping us with that. So, I spent a couple hours today building a Design by Human store for us, and getting everything ready, and getting everything together, and by doing that, it was able to leverage me a little bit, and we will probably be a part of the new Amazon merch beta, which is what I really want. That's already ordered a shirt and a hoodie. Oh, you found it. Oh, shit. Well, did she, or did you do that from the Teespring? Maybe that's what you did. Anyway, so the Amazon one's the one I really want because it'll help a lot with their SEO. The Amazon merch program is really great because you could search for it from anywhere on Amazon. You could type in HyperRPG on Google and you'll show up with an Amazon t-shirt. That's what I really want, because us getting our eyes out to more placers is great. That's what I want. Okay. Nagiyama asks, any reflection on your season premiere Gauntlet Tuesday and things you already want to change? Like I said, new graphics that I'm continuing to work on. We'll make a death graphic. We'll keep tightening up the sound effects. The other thing is we're going to make it very clear at the beginning that you can only set off a trap and you can only get a potion, that you are not allowed to say what that potion does or what that trap does. That is up to the GM, and that is the GM's call, because we can't have it breaking the game. The other thing that we're going to be doing is probably creating a system of cards for potions. That way we're not in a situation where you actually ask them, what kind of potion do you want? What do you want the potion to do? We want to be able to have multiple options and maybe like an affirmation matrix. Ryan wants to build an affirmation matrix kind of situation, but for the potions and for the traps. So that's Ryan's plan. What I really want to buy is kitchenware on Amazon that's HyperRPG branded. That's a very targeted.
Mugs.
Yeah, well, mugs, yes. I want mugs too. Zach, have you talked to some of the YouTube gaming channels like Nerdarchy and DomForgeCast and see cross promoting stuff? Both have Shadowrun games. I haven't talked to him, Chaotic Looney, but cross promotion doesn't work very well between YouTube and Twitch. It's easier for us to work with other streamers. As a business becomes larger, will property acquisition become part of your personal business model, folding established shows under your umbrella and assimilating their viewers as an outcome? Interesting question. That is a long-term goal, yes. That is definitely a long-term goal, Pyrocyte, but it's a goal that we have to succeed here first. We have to be in the black here first before we can start approaching other people to buy them out. But it is a long-term goal, and we have properties in mind. So let's see here. Branded jorts. Yeah, branded jorts. And Chum Chum Jim, he meant properties as in not the actual property you were on, but properties as in, other people's licenses. And it, other people's goods, like possibly buying out other Twitch shows and bring them into our fold. Angelus, are you a part of the t-shirt group? If you are, good. Okay. Dawn Forgecast does have a Twitch channel. Okay, Chaotic Looney. I mean, it's weird because it's like you gotta have a face-to-face. If you just message someone out of the cold, it can be a little weird. Alright, Dutch Teddy, we do. They're asking to turn down the music. They said it's too loud and they can't hear very well. But the property we're on also doesn't work well, and the lease is up in February, so that's gonna be an interesting time. Alright. We might have to build a new set somewhere. You say wouldn't be so bad. Rai wasn't here when we built the last one.
Yes, so I can get initiated.
Rai didn't have to build the last set, and he's all like, that wouldn't be so bad. Oh.
I'm just saying, I remember. It's a new opportunity to create a bigger and better set.
Yeah.
Selling
the Smash Mechs from game sessions could help, says Craving More. We tried that once. We reuse a lot of the parts on those mechs, so it's a thought, but the shows do not have sponsors like Loot Crate and Nerdblock, Trogaf, because we don't have enough viewers yet. We're still pretty new, and we're a grassroots organization. We're building from the ground up. We do have a new sponsorship deck that we're hoping to shop around. We just have met with we have some new business help on that end that's helping with the sponsorship deck. So we're hoping to shop that around here really soon. Okay, next question. This is from Z101. Hi HyperRPG, Z101 here. I have a suggestion. I'm watching your shows via YouTube. I'm based in Bangkok, Thailand. The time difference makes it hard for me to follow you guys live. That said, I recently subbed to support the great work you're doing, but did so during a time when you were not online. As such, I didn't get to see you guys receive the donation, which would be a subscriber actually. Would it be possible to queue up donations to receive during off times and give them a shout out during a specific show? That would be awesome. I think this is actually a pretty good idea. So here's what I propose. Rai.
Yo.
I got work for you, guy.
Oh, good.
So.
I just put
what? Yeah. Oh, okay.
What's up?
When you guys are doing the morning update, mm-hmm. You should read off any subscribers that happened the night before.
It's a very good idea.
Because it's usually only two or three.
That's super easy.
Boom.
I can do that.
HyperRPG, can you offer us new mechs to buy through you all? We only have whatever's been ready to be 3D printed, and we put up two a week. We've been putting up two a week, so they are up.
Totally new mech that's never been used on the show before, up for grabs.
Oh, there's a new mech up for grabs. What is it called?
The Stalker.
The Stalker. An assault mech.
It is a gunboat.
Cool. Hey, Castorina, thank you for that resubscribe. Very much appreciated. Alright. Negiyama asks, how excited are you for Alex to come out, and do you think you can convince him to moving his business/studio? Negiyama, that's the plan. And you can guarantee why Alex is up here. We are all going to be trying to convince him to move out here and work with us. So, so the Stalker is a great missile boat. Yeah. So, what's up, Varshal? Yeah, Alex is great. He's a great addition to the team when he's around. Yeah, we know that, Bakamochi guy. But subs don't really need to get announced out loud. And he was saying subs. He meant to say subs instead of donations. Kesatarina. Oh shit. Thank you.
Also warning.
Thank you, 4 AM Critter. Thank you for that. Yes, Trograph, it is really expensive. It's really expensive. That's why that show has really high overhead. So that's why we have this system that allows people to buy purchasables and things like that, because we pay a lot of talent on that show, we pay for a lot of pre-production on that show, and we pay for a lot of actual production of the mechs and everything else. So we need those systems in place. So that's how this channel is funded, actually. It is those donations. From you all, and your contributions keep the lights on, but we want to make sure that you're getting a lot out of it. So it's finding that right balance for us of getting enough to keep the lights on and try to make the company work and pay everyone's salaries while also covering all of our day-to-day costs and everything like that without ever making it feel like we're just trying to take money to get all this profit, because we don't want to do that. We just want to succeed and do cool stuff. All right. Nagiyama asks, Z101 asked again, would still be great if you could mention it in shows since it reflects the hype about IPRPG. Also, viewers like me can then feel included and rejoice on YouTube later, like the clip idea. Yes. All right. Nagiyama asked, what is tonight's music? I answered that earlier. Yeah, it's Chelsea Wolf right now. Krillin says, Zach, you seem slightly grumpier than usual. What's up? Actually, I'm in a really good mood. So, what's up with you? Why are you trying to, like, put your thoughts and emotions on me, dog? Red Fangs just says, whoops, nothing else. Prosperous Guard, hey Zach, we hit the sub goal and that's awesome. Regarding the merch store, what are your plans to start? Alright, already answered that. Do you have a startup idea? When will suggestions improvement channel contributions be considered? I'm unsure of what you mean by that, because we're constantly taking ideas that you guys have and installing them every single day. We're kind of doing that every day. I don't know what you really mean by that. And stuff's always being kind of worked on. Like, we've got people working on the website now and helping out with that. I've got the basics of it built, like, set down, and we have people working on it. It's just a lot of things. From yesterday, is Paizo a friend of yours? Yes, Paizo is a great friend of ours. So, Trograph, one of the cool things about HyperRPG, since I know you're new, and thank you for subscribing right when you came in. I really appreciate that. Is that we are kind of up here in Seattle for our ability to work directly with game developers. It's a way for us, while being here, there's so many around that we get to have direct conversations with them and talk to them about how the shows work. So Paizo yesterday sent out a big giveaway to one of our winners. They gave us the banners. They worked with us on the system. They gave us all the minis. So Paizo is a great friend, and we really appreciate their contributions. All right. No, Fleckerly, nobody was killed on the roof, dude. So, anyway, are we getting events out of PAX, like meeting up with people that might want to come out, or even companies? Maybe some companies. We had some talks with people that we met. Hopefully those lead to business deals. Lemire, maybe a spreadsheet so you can see what each of... Hey!
Thanks for responding to my suggestions, Zach.
Aww.
Love the community engagement and how. You are responding to everyone's questions and suggestions. Great work. Thanks so much.
Thank you, Z101. Thank you for that contribution. Thank you so much. It all goes a long way. And hello from Bangkok. Like, what time is it over there? You should join us in the chat room. That's a long ways away. If Malika was here, she would be like, oh my god, I'm from Thailand. Did you know I'm from Thailand? We should talk about it. And she'd get really excited. Okay. Let's see, what's next? Okay, maybe a spreadsheet so we can see what each slot is and cross them off. Reduce things he has in front of him for traps and potions. Yeah, we'll figure it out. It's 12:53 p.m. in Bangkok. Midday, taking a lunch break. Nice! Alright. Sko_, what is Honesty Hour? So, Honesty Hour, for those that don't know, if you're just tuning in, is a chance for you all to ask direct questions. I'm the CEO of HyperRPG. I'm really busy throughout a lot of the day, and since this works, what's up, Late Night Tabletop? Because as a full channel with all these different hosts and shows and all this stuff, you don't get much time to actually have a one-on-one conversation here. Whereas if we were just playing games with you all day, there'd be a lot more of that. So since we don't have that, we go the opposite extreme route, where it's just a one-on-one conversation where I answer you guys questions about the community, about the channel, where the money is going, how we're spending that money, how we plan on growing, being extremely honest with all of the things that are currently going on, and just, we consider everyone watching an investor. What products do you use in your hair? This is, what is this? This is called not showering this morning when I woke up. That's what this is called. not showering. Thank you for that resubscribe. Oh shit, here you go with the tough questions. Ozai75, how's your health going? Pretty rough. Pretty rough. Kingly Love 101, we are a hyper RPG channel. And what that means is we do mainly large role-playing game shows with multi-camera setups, all sorts of other stuff. And we have all sorts of big camera switching type shows that are heavily produced where you get a chance to watch interesting role-playing stuff. And we do a lot. I don't know, man. It's really hard to set. Like, we do really big RPGs. It's great. And sometimes we do more intimate stuff. Sometimes we just play games. But we always try to add something to it to make it unique and different than something else you might find on Twitch. So, I love the Bloodshot figurine. He looks dope. Yeah, Valiant sent that to us as a little present. And it's awesome. I'm really happy with the relationship we have with Valiant Comic Books. They're really great, and they're doing amazing work, and I'm really happy that we get to be a part of that world. Alright, let's get some more questions in here, guys. I went through Discord, so now we'll start answering ones from the chat room. So you guys feel free to ask questions. I'll answer what I can. Hey! Thank you, Trogaf. Aw, thank you, Trogaf. Me too! Me too. It is, though. Like, this has been a really good week so far. We've already had more subscribers this week than we've had in the last 2 weeks combined. So that's great. That we need to keep that momentum. I really want to keep that momentum. Tomorrow we have a really fun day. We're going to be playing Dreadnought with the community on LAN Party. We're also going to be playing Off the Trails tomorrow, which is two comedians playing video games in a really funny way. And then we've got Trivia Hops, and I'm really excited about tomorrow night because it's Arnold Schwarzenegger night, and I am a huge Arnold fan, and it's gonna be a lot of fun. With Paizo releasing a new game called Starfinder, a sister project Pathfinder, have you considered another RPG show this way, showcasing good sci-fi RPG show? Gorstag, we are considering a sci-fi RPG show, but it's not gonna be Pathfinder, it's gonna be fucking Star Wars. Alright, we're gonna do some Fantasy Flight Star Wars, because that system is fucking dope, and we're working on that.
It's honest, Yara. Can I be honest about how excited I am about something small?
Okay, Emily wants to come out and be excited about something really small.
It's not that small. It's pretty fucking awesome. Twitter just is gonna start making it so that you can put media on it. It won't take away your character count. This is amazing!
What do you mean media on? So, like, when you insert a
videos,
picture,
pictures,
it's not
GIFs,
gonna take away.
It's not gonna take any space.
Oh, that's something that would excite you, but not, I don't really care.
I wanted to tell everybody. I'm just excited.
Star Wars, fucking, how will that work, says Crid. It's gonna be great. We have a meeting with a possible GM soon. So we're working on that. That new system's really great for storytelling. And, Zach, do you have any prior experience with DMing / GMing before this channel? No. Valiant was my very first, GM experience. Blah, blah, blah. Now they're coming in really fast. If I miss something, guys, just repeat it again, and I'll try to get to it. How do you have a relationship with Magpie or 1-7 by any chance? Would love to see Blaze in the Dark get some love. You know, I don't, Sammy Jeeves, but we're always reaching out to new people. Zach, folks are still using the Discord, so you should peek at it once in a while. I will every once in a while. I want to give the chat room that's not in Discord a chance to. Alright, Hunter, to be completely honest with you guys, our long-term goal is to get rid of Trivia Hops and have a large RPG every night of the week.
It's downloaded on my computer, and it has the same notes as this one.
Alright, is the other one downloading too?
Yep, all of them are.
All four have a download going? Perfect.
All three, the fourth one doesn't.
Why not?
Myself, Ryan, and Emily.
You can start a download without logging in. If not, log in with my username. We need to get started on all four.
Well, okay.
I wanted to Zach ask how much it costs you guys to construct the set in which you film most of the shows. Just the primary set, including the cost of mics and lights, just the bare bones set. The bare bones set was extremely thrifty. It came in under 10 grand. So. Well, that's the thing, Crid. We've got to get bigger first. So, long term goal is to get rid of it. Hey! Thank you.
Hi, Zach. It's Pope Athedjo. Hashtag evil, hashtag. #hashtag
Are you done? Okay. So, it's a long-term goal, guys. Trivia Hops is already something that's getting a little old for us, and we're going to run out of guests, and we're going to run out of topics. So it's always been kind of a long-term goal to eventually have RPGs every night of the week. That's been our long-term goal. So, eventually, that is what we want to do, because we can't ignore, you know, the elephant in the room that is Critical Role. But Trivia Hops has done okay. It's building up an audience. And there's millions of people watching Twitch, so we can't sit here and be like, brr. Alright, is there any way there can be a limit on length of donation messages? There might be, I could probably make it happen. Malidel, as such a passionate person and hard worker, how do you deal with getting burnt out? I'm kind of burnt dealing with family stuff lately. Alright, Malidel, this is a good conversation to have. How do you deal with not getting burnt out? That's a really good question. What?
Do you have an account?
Yeah, but don't ask me that question right now. Like, get it ready and I'll do it later. I'm in the middle of having a conversation. That's okay. Okay, so anyway. How do you keep from getting burnout? So, that's a really good question. And it's not just about find a passion, because people still get burnout on their passions. What I like about Twitch or certain other things, and it's a trick I use on myself to keep from getting burnout, because this is a really strenuous job, and for me, it's multitasking. And I understand that's a little different, but I'm going to try to find a way to reach it back, like, bring it back around for you when dealing with family and other things like that. And it's not just multitasking, it's finding what I like within each of those multitasks. So, I'll spend an hour working on one thing, and they'll say, okay. Now I'm going to spend an hour working on this thing, and I'll say, okay. And then I'll spend an hour working on this thing, and I'll say, okay. And I'll make them kind of separate tasks with different parts of my creative brain that allow me to utilize different skills that I have to where I'm constantly kind of engaging in a different way, which keeps me from getting really burnt out on one of them. And when it comes to like other tasks, what I would say is find what you like in each of the smaller things. If it's say you're getting like burnt out with family stuff and things like that, what are the little things that you like that you can focus on in one segment and then pull back from and go back into another segment or thing that you like and then pull back? Because if you're just looking at a broad picture of the weight of what you're dealing with, like if I looked at the broad picture of the weight of the channel and the weight of all that we're doing, I would get burnt out too. I would get extremely dragged down and I would get really tired. So I have to focus on the small sometimes and create those checklists of just like, all right, that's done. Now, moving on, that's done. I'm really big on small accomplishments. Small accomplishments help me get through the day without getting like knocked down. So finding those little victories too, like those little moments that I can be like, all right, did it, great, fucking awesome, we did that, now moving on. And that's part of what I like about this kind of content. Is you do it and it's done and you have to move on and make it better for next time. You can't dwell on it. And I would say life can be very similar. Once it's done, don't dwell. Focus on what you can. I am like, because I'm in constant chronic pain, it does make me seem like I'm always angry, but deep down I'm actually quite the optimist and quite positive and always saying like, okay, don't focus on the bad, focus on what was good in that situation and what we can improve on. And that's what helps me keep from getting burnt. All right, I know there were some other questions in there. Let's see. Let's get the other questions going back in. How's the chance of paranoia? Maybe. It's a maybe. We were supposed to do it in August, and we had planned on doing it August, and then 3 weeks before August, Don told us, oh, I'm going out of town for the entire month of August, and we had been planning the entire time to do it then. So, that got put on the back burner, because that was the plan, and then that plan got canceled on us. Zach, I can assume the seriousness of term investors in regards to subscribers, yet it seems questions of expenses are common, which shows a genuine concern to the stream's livelihood. Would you be willing to offer to subscribers a spreadsheet on those expenditures to help visualize the areas of spent? No, Pyrocyte. That is a door I do not want to open. I will be open with everyone and sharing what I need to, but if there's anything I know about you guys as an audience, is sometimes you're overeager and you take things the wrong way, or you look at something and you only apply half knowledge, and it's not to say that you wouldn't understand, but you would never have the entire picture. So you would be jumping to conclusions, and you would be making rash decisions on things that you don't fully understand. And that is not a position to be in. Just like with our main investor, we'll share everything, but with certain other people who are involved with the channel, like sponsors and things like that, you don't show them all those things because they're not gonna get it, and they're gonna make rash judgments, and they're gonna make like conclusions that are just completely incorrect. So that is not something we're willing to share. Yeah, it would be a shit of a fire, Snow TS. There's no way. We will always be very honest and open with you, though. So, in telling you exactly how things are going. Okay. Yeah, you're all professional sound engineers too. Yeah, it's not. Okay, alright, so let's get some more questions going in there, guys. Did the channel break into black or come close? Okay, so, Naltrus, it would have if not for Gen Con. So, that's unfortunate. If it wasn't for Gen Con, we actually would have been in the black last month. So we're close, we're really close, guys. We're on schedule to possibly be this month. And let's keep it up, let's keep this shit up. How are the new boom mic setups working out? These are the same boom mics we've been using since day one, SnowTS. If you're talking about the new like side mics, the personal mics, I like them. I think it allows the GM to come through clear at all times. At minimum, anyone who doesn't run a business wouldn't understand, just like people thought it was bad that they're almost in the black at this point. Because even in under a year, we're doing pretty good. For 6 months into, or yeah, technically like 7 months into a business, we're doing pretty good. Blast Ronin, that's not something that's on our radar right now. And yeah, Kiyohoga, we do have an indie RPG show on the channel, so if there's an RPG of a system you really like, suggest it to us, and we can run it by Strix and see if it's something she's interested in running. Like, that is our kind of experimental show, where we want to be able to run stuff that we couldn't run otherwise. KB Tibbs, we're going to be trying to build a cash cushion for a little bit because we had a big investment at the beginning. So first we have to start trying to pay that back. First and foremost, we have to start trying to pay back that initial investment. So we're going to be trying to sit on a cash cushion for a while. Because live content's very scary. You never know what's going to happen. Are there any plans to have any of the other cast members from Critical Role and Hyper RPG in the future? Litharion, if any of them are in Seattle, they're going to be on the channel. Because we're friends. And if they're up here, we're going to bring them on. How is your relationship with Geek and Sundry? Everyone that works on that Twitch set is a good friend. And I'll end it at that. Are you using any of the Champions RPG materials to supplement your Valiant materials? Not at all. Our Green Paradox. It's all from Valiant and up here. And a lot of it is made up on the fly just to deal with the stuff. How is your personal life, Zach? Doing as well as you can be mentally? I mean, mentally, I think I'm about the same as I've always been. Like, physical stuff gets harder every year. And especially with this kind of like work schedule with 16 to 18 hour days, it's, yeah. Have you thought on leasing space to bands or others during downtimes? Cravenmore, we've actually been talking about opening it up on the weekends for other streams, like events, to rent out. It's just, it's a whole nother thing to get into, and we almost have to have someone pushing for it, and we can't afford to hire someone to push it. So it's something we're kind of trying to sip, like slip out there and see if anyone bites and comes back. But we've been putting that on people's minds because we are one of the only Twitch studios in the entire area. Well, we technically are right now. But it would have to be on weekends. Let's see. Have you had any weird or cool dreams lately? Not that I remember. It's usually just stressing out. Waking up like, I gotta get to work. Who's tromping around on the roof all day? They were doing roofing and didn't bother telling us they were gonna be doing it, so they'll get an angry letter from me, that's for sure. Savage Punch, I'd have to find the right person to set up hats. I don't know. Any ideas for the new sub goal, and did lowering the last one from 1500 help incentive for subs? Okay, Ghost Children, we need to get back into the every 50 we do a big giveaway thing. And I think when we put a 1500, that was a mistake. Okay, well, yes and no. I'm aware of when we have new viewers. Hey! Subscribe. Hey, thank you for that subscribe! Boom! Thank you for that. Very much appreciated. So, part of the reason that sub goal was so high at 1500 is I wanted to take some pressure off of the audience who was already here, knowing that it was a little ways away. Because we know when we have new viewers or not. So we kind of laid off the whole, let's get 50 more subs for a giveaway. Let's get 50 more subs for a giveaway. Let's get 50 more subs for a giveaway. Thank you for subscribing, Firefly Bug. We kind of laid off on that because we know when we have new viewers. We've got new viewers this week, so we'll be back on pushing for subs. We don't push for them when we know that 90% of our audience is subbed and the people who aren't subbed are just because they don't have the money or want to. And we don't want to make people feel bad. So we try not to push it when we know what that's the situation. When new people come in, we'll push for subs again. But for there for a couple months, there was nobody new, so it didn't make sense to really push it that hard, so. Alex didn't make that sub song, actually. That's a song. It's just a remix song that I like. That's the idea. What's up, Dexter Morgan 64? How you doing? Being a natural loner myself, Zach, how do you keep yourself from retreating to a safe place even when you have a lot of things going on in life? I must find myself battling that daily. Geek 40, for me, man, I thrive on work. I thrive on tasks. Tasks keep me from getting lost within my own nihilistic bullshit self. Hey! No fucking way! I'm not gonna say it. I'm not gonna say it. Thank you for that. You, thou who shall not be named. Thank you, Jalapeno Business 12, for that. Thank you for that follow. Very much appreciated. Thank you for that. Yep. No, it's fine. It's fine. Thank you for your subscription. It's appreciated. Zach, thanks for the flooring installation stream. It was a weird thing. Yes, it was a weird thing, wasn't it? It was a weird thing. Indeed it was. So, where were we on our questions about, I think we were talking about subscribers and all that kind of stuff. Do guests like Mercer screw your analytics a lot? No, actually, Trograph, they don't, because, okay, so, here's the thing, Trograph, we're really proud of the content we're making, and we know that in actuality, a lot of the stuff that we're doing on this channel is more what people who follow Mercer would like watching than even Geek & Sundry. I know that because I took a lot of feedback while I was at Geek & Sundry, and I took a lot of notes, and kind of built this channel based off what all of that kind of community was telling me they wanted to see on Twitch. So everything we've created here was through an entire year of me keeping feedback and taking notes and seeing what people were really wanting and they weren't getting out of the channel. So we're extremely confident that when people like Matt come on, we'll have really high retention because a lot of this channel is built around the type of role playing that they want to see and they just don't know we exist yet. So we have a pretty confident idea that people that like Critical Role are likely going to like one of the shows on our channel. If they are actually RPG fans and watch other shows on Twitch. I understand that a lot of people who watch Critical Role don't watch anything else on Twitch, which we're not going to retain those people. That's a special breed of person that's not really like, you know, they skew things, but those aren't the people who also showed up last night. We're really confident of the content we're creating. For one, we have the highest retention rate on all of Twitch, so we're confident that we'll be able to convert people because we make good content and we work really hard to do it and people see that, and we have a lot of different types of shows that a lot of types of shows for people to watch, lots of different types of role-playing shows. Let's see. Oh, thank you, Trogaf. Twitch being a new medium. Hey, fucking shit. Subscribe. Thank you for that subscribe. Appreciate that. Thank you for that. Very much appreciated. Thank you for your subscriptions, guys. That's great. Thanks. My job is weird. My job is really weird. Zach, sorry to raise the dead, just thought of it. Perhaps its Crit Role starts later than Harper G primetime content. Move Star Wars show 1 hour earlier to better avoid the viewer sink. Maybe, Hunter. It's a conversation we've been having, lately. Honest query, do you feel the DFA is getting a bit overly gimmicky each week, pushing away from earlier support viewers? Gorstag, I'm glad you asked. So, last week was a misstep, and I can tell you why it was a misstep. Because there were some assumptions that were made, and we will make sure that doesn't happen again. I think Dan was actually really great. Because Dan was playing a part, and he was being entertaining, and he was a gimmick, but he was also deadly. And he was a good villain, and he was dangerous. So, I like Dan. The problem with Erica and Mark is there were a lot of missteps taken by people behind the scenes where they weren't told anything because PAX had them bogged down. They literally drove from PAX to here. And what that created was a situation where everyone was going into it with no idea what was going to happen, no preparation, and they literally knew absolutely zero about how to play Battletech. That was not good. Them saying they didn't know they could retreat, them doing things on the battlefield like turning their back to the enemy and taking it just a little too far, has to do with them not realizing it was a dangerous world. So that was a misstep, and it won't happen again because I talked to everybody after the show, and we're working on getting a one sheet ready for guests that gives them the basic rule set, that gives them a basic outlier of what they can and can't do and how they should and shouldn't act. PAX kind of screwed us on that one. Usually there's more time to communicate between the guests and the GM and everything, but everyone was at PAX, so it was a misstep, and we're aware of that, and we'll fix it. Okay. After seeing all the new sub dancing, I want to be Zach's heterosexual life mate, or maybe just his friend. We'll be plutonic heterosexual life mates, PK Theater. Fuck you guys, Jesus Christ. Okay. Woo! That, I believe, is 5 subscribers, so we gotta do a Steam Key giveaway. Is anyone still here in the office? Alright, Emily, Steam Key giveaway time! You guys are wearing me out. Woo! All right. Steam key time. Okay. Yep, Emily's still here, guys. Which, why are you still here? Who's the winner? Empty knocked! Congratulations, Empty knocked. Yeah, seriously, Emily, why are you still here, dude? Go home. Go home. I'm sorry. Cause I told, yeah, I know I told you to do that too. What's taking so long, bro? Really? It's a pretty small file. Man, your computer sucks. Man, her and Rai's computers are both old pieces of shit that lose internet every day. Huh? Cause it was an old piece of shit. All right. Let's get some more questions going. See, Zach, that's why you can't have passionate people that work for you. They never leave. I know, Emily's a trooper. She's my number 2. I'm my number 1. No, Emily's working her ass off. She really wants this to work too. She said she would go down with the ship burning if she had to, so I mean she's a winner in my book. Alright. Does your location have motion sensitive lights or just lights that reduce utility costs? No, we don't, Grogap. We definitely don't. We have a lot of lights in here, we just have to turn them off at the end of the night. I'm one of those new viewers who came in because the channel was featured on Twitch. I've only been a follower for a few days, but I'm already a big fan. Ah, PK Theater! Thank you so much for that. I really appreciate that. Thank you for sticking around. If you have questions, ask. Now is the time to ask questions for those things that you want to know about. Sko, I'm not your monkey, dude. I might dance when you... I can't even back that up. I'm literally your monkey. Hey, great thing! Thank you for that follow. Question, the flowing drive was great. The community really jumped on to direct support. Is it possible to have more things like that, such as laptop drive? Nalturus, yes, but us succeeding and getting the black first is more important. So if it's something that I think we could benefit from, but we just can't afford because we're too worried about our budget, then we'll make a drive for it. But like something like a laptop for Emily, sorry Emily, but it's not a necessity for us to survive as a company, so. Krillin, I don't ignore you. I answered your questions in Discord earlier. Oh yeah, I should check Discord again. Let's see. All right. Any plans to rename the show Corporate Transparency? Nah, we're sticking with this. Like, I'm sticking with this because out of principle, to me, it represents what I wanted this channel to be. I used to do this show on Geek and Sundry. I was literally told by my bosses that I couldn't do it anymore. That I was not allowed to because I worked for a company and a company couldn't be sharing those kinds of things in that way. The reason I want to keep it named that is out of principle to say we're a company and this, because we can do that and we can succeed by doing that, and that if you're a company on a new platform such as Twitch that requires you to be transparent, you have to be ready to do so. So that's what I have to say to that. While I know this is an RP-driven channel, would you consider branching out into different niche categories of gaming, like speedrunning games? I'm very passionate about that. No, because we're not pros, Jellyfilled Donut. I'm a big believer in only being able to do what you do well. When you try to do something that other people do a lot better than you, you're, for one, you're putting yourself in a really bad situation. It's not a good idea. So we don't want to compete with all the people that do speedrunning really, really well. We do role-playing well, and we do production well. So we're going to focus on that, because that will help us stand apart. We're not pro-gamers, we're not pro-speedrunners. You little swagwalker? You goddamn right I will. Fuck yeah I will. Fuck yeah I will. And then I'll try to convince Valiant to cast me in something. Oh, it's Empire. That sucks. Bob Lordeth, that's really great to hear. I agree, Trogaf. We need to get some more emotes, too. I realized that the other day. We have some emote spots. What's up, Rascalian Jesus? Cool name. Hey, Zach. Our friend Joey Batman just arrived. Want to give him a pitch real quick? Hi, Joey Batman. We're a hyperactive, interactive, community-driven channel built by you for you. We do all sorts of really big content. Like large roleplay RPG shows. I GM a show on Monday nights called Valiant Vanquish, where we take superheroes through Valiant Universe, and maybe or maybe not they'll be super villains one day. Who knows? That's up to them and the story that they create. On Tuesday nights, we have a new show called The Gauntlet, where it's Pathfinder meets American Gladiator / Running Man. I like Running Man better, so I like to use that one. And they have 2 hours to collect as many skulls in a dungeon as possible. On Wednesday nights, what was earlier tonight, we had Shadowrun Corporate Sins, but tonight was a pet episode. It was really weird, but you guys liked it, so that's cool. Tomorrow night, we have a show called Trivia Hops. It's a drinking trivia show, and the theme tomorrow is Arnold Schwarzenegger, so you should definitely tune in for that. And then Friday nights, we have Death From Above, which is a giant Battletech smashing show with custom 3D printed mechs that we drill into, blow up, shit gets crazy, and we have all sorts of smaller side shows all throughout the week, but those are our tentpole shows, and you should definitely check them out. It's really pretty fucking cool, and you won't find anywhere else on Twitch. Because we created this shit! And I mean that in a positive way. Alright. I like to call Gauntlet a Pathfinder version of Super Smash TV. Yeah, it's pretty good, too. It's pretty good, too. Hey, Rapscallion Jesus, just followed. That's fucking awesome. Your little alert's gonna pop up any second now. Yojimbot's on the ball. Thank you, Rapscallion Jesus. Yojimbot is on the fucking ball. A gauntlet fist emoji? The Vanquish crew are already villains. Peanut Butter Babe, this is a Halo shirt. Halo Foundation. You can get this off their website. It's really great. And it goes to charity. Let's see. Whoa, we're getting raided by Firecrow? What? Would you kindly? Aw, shit. Aw, man, Firecrow. God damn it, why'd you do this, dude? I was gonna raid you when I went offline. Hellraiser AT22, thank you for following. God damn it, I was gonna raid Firecrow when he went up. Fuck! Peace Froggy, thank you for that follow. You were raising money tonight and I wanted to raid you and send a bunch of subscribers your way. Fuck, dude. Damn it, man, you beat me to it. Guys, go subscribe to Firecrow's channel right now. Firecrow's awesome. He's a real trooper. He was here at the barbecue. He's been here for LAN party. He's been really great. He's been trying to hook us up with all sorts of deals. He's been introducing us to great people. He's been a really great friend of the channel. You guys should definitely go check him out. Fucking get the, yeah, get, thanks for that raid defense, guys. We broke him so bad, try Friday. Stone Terror, thank you for that follow. But seriously, go subscribe to Firecrow if you haven't already. He's a channel friend. He's an awesome dude. He's part of Would You Kindly, good friend of Goobers. You should definitely check him out. Thank you, new followers. You just stepped into, what are some of the benefits are there for subscribing? I don't know the benefits that are for his channel for subscribing. Maybe one of his members can tell you. And Maxims, thank you for that follow. Very much appreciate it. Sturgis Daniel, thank you. Very much appreciate it. Thank you for that. Guys, hold your cannons. Yeah, chill out. Chill out. Hi, RPG, how many hours of prep do you do each week for GMing on Vanquished? For Vanquished, well, first off, welcome all you new viewers. Thank you for tuning in. This is Honesty Hour, it's a show where me as the CEO of this company talk to you guys about what is working on the channel, answering questions to the chat room. Sometimes shit gets really deep and really heavy and we talk about things like depression or you know, wants and ambitions and all sorts of other shit. Thank you, Bloodline Keeper, that alert right there. Thank you for that. Thank you for that follow. So, basically, this is a show right now where I talk to you guys and I answer questions. Every new subscriber, I dance like a fucking idiot, and that's how things work here. And every 5, we give away a Steam key. So, to answer that question about Vanquish, usually about 6 hours. This week, it was only an hour because of PAX, so it was nuts. Delta Otech, thank you for that follow. Troopers JP, we are going to be doing more multi-session games on weekly affirmations. We're going to do it. The problem is, Firecrow, thanks so much, man. I was going to raid you tonight, and you raided me first. It's not fair. We owe you one. We owe you one. Our mods, make sure and let us know next time Firecrow's online. We gotta show some love back. For most game masters, it's 1 hour pre for every hour play. Yeah. Kiyohoga. I wish that was the case for me. HollowWarrior88, thank you for that follow. But unfortunately with Vanquished, our players, they don't listen very well. And I have to come up with a lot of variables to keep them from dying. So I'm always trying to write out things about the world, not knowing the next time that one of them might drop themselves into an abyss. Fuck. Thank you for that! Subscribe! Liquid Fox, thank you for that follow. Very much appreciated. Ah, damn it. Just had to wait 30 minutes. So Jelly-Filled Donut, thank you for that. Thank you for that. God damn it. You guys are wearing me the fuck out. I'm gonna... God damn it. Okay, wait. What is this channel, says Stone Terror. Later, Emily. Thank you so much for staying late. Hi. Rascal Jesus says I'm so confused. Thank you for that subscription. Thank you for wearing me out. Chaotic Looney, thank you for that. This channel is a role-playing game show channel, so we are a high-production channel. I am the CEO of this company. Fuck you, god damn it! Subscribe. Ah! Thank you for that subscribing. Very much appreciate it. So, Zatch made the sub music extra long today as a troll, and I forgot that I was doing Honesty Hour tonight. The troll is on me! God damn it. Oh, HyperRPG Captain Blaine was asking what the sub benefits were here. Well, okay, when you subscribe to this channel, you get you access to all our awesome emotes, but that's pretty standard. You guys know all that. The other thing is you get access to our Discord, and on our Discord, one second. Okay. The other is that you get access to our Discord. On our Discord, you get access to our metagame, and it's currently being revamped right now, but basically that metagame allows you to join a corporation, one of the corporations that's represented from our Corporate Sin Shadowrun show. So there's 10 corporations that exist within this world, and there's more stuff coming your way soon, but I can't tell you about that right now. And basically, you get to join that, you get to be a part of the community. We also have like 20 to 25 different rooms in that Discord that are all extremely active, where you get to give live discussion and feedback on the channel, because we consider you guys investors, and that's what this show is right now. This show is us talking to you. Fuck! Subscribe. Thank you for that subscription, it's very much appreciated. No, this does not happen during our RPG shows, which is partly why we dance when we're not doing an RPG, to make up for it. Because we want there to be at least some sort of connection there. Fuck! Okay, let's get back to the questions, alright? Questions would be great. Trogaf asks, I like your no bullshit open approach. Do you ever put on a character and hide your true feelings about something as a business practice? Direct Fletch, I don't know how to do that. It got me in trouble at my last job. Because I'm... Okay, so here's a true story. The way I was raised, or what I got to see. So, some of you guys saw my dad on Trivia Hops. He was an interesting father. Very strict. Extremely, extremely, extremely strict. And, so I hate to liken this to something else. Is this like a Geek and Sundry where there is one main channel with many different shows that go on? I really don't like doing that, but I'm new in Firecrow and new here. Stone Terror, I used to run Geek and Sundry, so that's kind of not, I built Geek and Sundry from the ground up, so it's my business model. So it is similar in that way, but we're a lot more interactive here and all of our shows have to do with audience feedback and engagement. So it's similar, but a step above. But anyway, so going back to that story, though my dad was like not really, like he was extremely cold, frigid. Like I said, you guys saw the first time my dad and I ever really hugged on that show because someone paid $500 for us to hug, which was a real fucking shitty troll. But whatever. But what I did see from him was ethics.
Money. Oh, well, Zach, it's just a donation. Take a seat, brother. Hashtag Munit, hashtag hash browns.
Thanks for that, Genova. Thanks for that. Thanks for that. Whew! Okay. So, basically, what he really, really insulted me was ethics. So, 2 years out of my life, he was fighting a lawsuit and kind of a little mini Enron thing. He used to be a plant manager for a boat company down in Arkansas. And the head owners of that company were stealing money from people's 401ks. And thank you, GrimGirl15, for that follow. Very much appreciated. I remember going through that and hearing his kind of speeches. And how I saw the struggle that he went through to fight for what was right. And I was also raised on Spider-Man comic books, basically. But still, it was my dad that installed a lot of that into me, where when you're in a position to take care of others, you should do so. And for 2 years, we lost a lot of money. He was without work. We were extremely poor. But it was for the right thing. It was because he was in a position where he caught someone who was in power taking from others who couldn't defend themselves. And he decided to help stand up and defend for them and it almost destroyed a lot of like what he had worked to put our family together on. And it's one of those things that really, really, like, deep down affected how I try to live my life now, which is based on this kind of ethics of, it makes me really bad at business sometimes, especially when I was working in the entertainment industry and at my last job, because when I see that there's an injustice going on, I will fight for it for as long as I can, but if I'm told that I can't change it, I refuse to stand up for it and be a part of it. So that's partly why this channel exists. Even though it's a Twitch channel, our employees have benefits. They're full-time employees, they're salary employees. Everyone gets a small split of the revenue when we go profitable. We have a 5% revenue share once we reach profit. So that to me is what's important. And the basis of what you guys know from the community we've been able to create on Twitch too, of like, you can be a good person on the internet. So yeah. What injustices are you referencing? I don't have to even say anything. You guys can just keep watching shit, and I'm guessing it'll all come out eventually. No one can hide their injustices forever. They can't. It's impossible. I agree with you, Underwear Gnome. I hope we get to move into a new place, because this place sucks. What?
Good on Snow. You for taking care of your people. Hashtag respect brands.
Thank you, Goobers 515, man. Lurking and working. Thanks, Goobers. Thanks, Snow. Lurking and working. All right. Yeah, get some sleep, Goobers. Jesus Christ. I'm looking for more questions. Looking for questions. Any plans on new tattoos in the future? I don't know, man. I never really planned for them. It just happened. Matt is just a host at Geek and Sundry. He's just a host. He has a contract as a private contractor host. Can you tell us the worst stories you have from working at a dock? Oh, really, Sko? Oh, thanks, Firecrow. Okay, this is a fun one. This is a fun one. Oh, and there's some new questions in there. Oh, Startup Pit B. Startup the Pit B. Thank you for that follow. Very much appreciated. Okay, so Sko wants me to share some stories about working in a boat dock because he says it's been driving him nuts, which that's funny, it's been driving you nuts. But it was an extremely, extremely interesting job. Rapscallion Jesus, every single thing that we do on this channel is on YouTube, separated in playlists, so everything. And it gets put up within a day or two. So you can go to youtube.com/hyperrpg, it's all up. Okay, so stories about a boat dock. Working on a boat dock in the middle of Arkansas/Missouri, middle of fucking nowhere, closest city was 2.5 hours away. Oh shit! Okay, thank you for that subscription. That is another 5. We're doing a Steam Key giveaway. Can one of the mods pull a winner and then send it to Emily so she can give it away? Fuck! Firecrow, I've been dancing for subs before Goobers was born. Ain't that the truth, though? Because I'm older than him. Okay. It's great. Okay, so stories. Vic the Bitter, you just won a Steam Key. Thank you. Vic the Bitter just won a Steam Key. Thank you for that. Woo woo! Woo woo! Okay, so. I'm dead though, right? Okay. Captain Blaine, everything's on YouTube, man. Everything's on YouTube. Like, literally, if you're not subscribed, you can watch everything on YouTube. Litharion, they're gonna be Steam Keys for Necropolis. Thank you, Reskillian Jesus. Good night. Thanks for tuning in. Alright, Sko, I'm gonna get to it. Okay, so, I worked on this boat dock in the middle of the country. I didn't think anything was weird about it, because it was all I knew. And I need, yes, Niskar Gordon, I need to work on my cardio, but can't for reasons. Okay. KB Tibbs, The Jerk is a great movie, and I recognize that quote. Getting back to the story, I did not realize how weird my job was that me and all my brothers had, including my father had for years, was how weird it was until I went off to college, and I realized that the world didn't work that way. So, from the age of 12 all the way up to 21, I worked at a boat dock. And from 14 to 18, I worked probably 70 hours a week, 7 days a week, from like open to close in the middle of the summer. It entailed everything from scuba diving, hand weed whacking the side of a cliff, knowing how to adjust the docks based on water levels and things like that, roofing, fiberglass work on the top of boats and stuff, cleaning fish, keeping stock inventory, drinking coffee with really, really creepy old men that like to watch girls in bathing suits every morning. It was lots of random jobs together because out in the middle of nowhere, and there were just a couple of us that worked there because there was no workforce out in the middle of nowhere. But a lot of the day, depending on the season, if it wasn't a holiday, it was slow as shit. So I would do my chores, my work, basically, and I'd fish, I'd swim, repair docks. It's a pretty sweet ass fucking job. But there were a lot of really, really weird people. Yeah, getting BJs from MILFs. They offered, all right? They offered. So the big thing was you got a lot of rednecks out there in the middle of nowhere. You drink a lot, and alcohol and rednecks, man. Holy shit. That's a combination that leads to some crazy stuff. God, man. There's one time, this drunk woman, we were charging her damage to a boat she'd done on one of her boat rentals. And she was really upset and really belligerent. And we had our CB in the office and everything. And like, she straight up said, I'm gonna go to my truck, I'm gonna get my gun, and we're gonna come back and have a conversation. Second she leaves, we locked the main doors to the dock, which were two like glass doors, and they were one, like you couldn't see in, but we could see out, like it was a one-way mirror kind of situation. I don't know why, oh no, I know why we did that. It was for heat. It was to keep the heat out for all the goods that we had inside. And then we called the water patrol on the CB, and we're like, hey man, we got a lady with a gun out here. And she's threatening to shoot us or whatever. So she goes to her car, she gets her rifle out of the back of her truck, and we see her walking down the way. And as she's walking down the way, we see the water patrol boat breaking the wake barrier and is coming in at like full speed with this siren on. She is too drunk to even fucking notice and just keeps walking up with her rifle to like look at us. And we see him kind of pull up, and like if you're looking out the front, you see his boat kind of go by, and you hear the siren, and then you hear it stop. She walks up, and she's like pointing the gun at the window. It's like, you motherfuckers are gonna come out and face me, you motherfuckers, and just yelling stuff. And you hear on the other side of the dock that like, and you just hear him like chucking down the fucking thing. And you just see him out of nowhere, flying through the air, fucking like tackling her across the dock and into the water where the gas pump area was. And just slamming her down. And it was one of the funniest and most glorious things we've ever seen. It's like something straight out of a movie where you just have a limited peripheral view and you hear it coming from the back, just thump, 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 thump. And that little split second where the footsteps stop and you just see a body flying through the air and just, so gratifying. So gratifying. Yeah, she was drunk as fuck and got arrested, and it was hilarious. We all thought that was a good time. But I worked with people too. I worked with people too who were extremely redneck. Like, I was one of, we'll say, the only cultured people that worked there. And our boss, the guy who owned the place, lived in Florida, and he was never there. And basically, me and a couple other kids ran that place. And the guy that was my manager on this one summer was probably 3 years older than me, and I was 15. Like, he was probably 18 or 19. He's kind of an idiot redneck. And we had this sign in there that was like, the customer is never right. We're like, we are the final straw kind of thing. And being that a lot of people are drunk and everything, we kind of had this free reign. It was like, you know what? Fuck them. Like, they're not right. And he would say stuff to customers that extremely offensive. A lot of stuff I won't repeat here because we're a very friendly channel. I am from the Missouri-Arkansas border in the middle of nowhere. I remember one time this woman came in and she was upset because she was looking around her boat dock and she couldn't find any tampons, and she asked the guy working behind the counter, "Do you guys have any sanitary napkins?" And he reaches below the counter without even flinching and pulls up an entire roll of paper towels and sets it down in front of her and just sits there and keeps chewing his bubble gum and staring at her and doesn't say a word. And she gets really upset and embarrassed and like flips him off and walks out. And he's like, "I thought she wanted napkins." He didn't know what a sanitary napkin was, but it was fucking hilarious. Oh man. Lots of stuff I won't share though, but I saw a lot of really bad shit too. Cause like I said, when injuries happened, there was nobody to come help. Cause we were about an hour and a half helicopter ride away, and about 40 minutes for an ambulance response to the closest kind of town. When people, I did an hour and a half of CPR on an old woman once. We had a woman's leg get cut off. People's shoulders taken off from boating accidents. People dying, falling off the cliffs and stuff. Saw some fucked up shit at a really young age because I was the only person around to help. How old is Hyper RPG and how is the company doing, asked Stone Terror. We are 7 months in of streaming right now, just 7 months. Or is it six? I think it's technically the end of 6 months right now. And the company is really close to being in the black. So we're doing really good. I know for people they get freaked out because they're like, "Oh, we aren't making profit yet." But we're a young company. So the other thing was the cast of characters that lived around there. Oh, I did get to see two different people get struck by lightning. That's an experience. Also, one of the scariest things in the world, one of the scariest things in the world ever is working on a boat dock where you've got all these underwater kind of gas lines and shit, and you would hear you'd see lightning hit on top of the hill on the lake, because it's like in the Tri-Lake area in southern Missouri, so there's crazy thunderstorms all summer long, and you'd see lightning like strike up on the hill or something, and the static electricity would make, you would hear it going through the gas pipes underneath and be like, and you would eventually see like the numbers on those old gas, the old click kind of numbers on the old gas pumps, super fucking old on that boat dock. You'd see the numbers kind of flip and stuff. It's one of the scariest fucking feelings in the world. Like every time you'd feel the hair just come up on the back of your neck, like, I'm about to blow. Like, you just imagine that whole thing going off and you flying through the fucking air or something. Pretty nuts. But there was a cast of people that lived down there, like cast of characters that my brother and I, Lucas, who runs Geek and Sundry now, we talked about writing a movie about our experience working down there. Kind of like, what was it called? Like, Adventureland or something like that. You know, like, that kind of, like, movie where it's like a coming of age kind of thing and all the people around it. And as we started writing it out, we're like, holy shit, the people, Lucas worked there too, man. all of my brothers. We all went through it. All of us. Sorry, I keep reading questions in the chat and I get distracted. And once we started writing out these characters, we're like, no one's gonna believe they exist. They're too cartoonish for movies. They become characters because they are. And they're human, and it's like, how do we represent them? Like, they are human and they're great. But the funniest shit they ever did, like, you can't put that stuff in movies because it's just too much. It's just, you just don't believe it. It doesn't make sense. And that's how I feel like growing up in the middle of fucking nowhere, Ozarks is because, like I said, we had a guy with a pet raccoon that would walk, that he would wear on his shoulder. We had a dude who only drank goat's milk, who walked around naked everywhere, who was over 80 and was super healthy and strong, named Phil, mind you, who was a wrestler for the military back in like the fucking 40s and shit. Built like a brick shit house, but he just walk around naked whistling. Just like super happy guy, but he'd walk around naked taking care of his goats and stuff, and he was a boat mechanic too. But he also was extremely, extremely racist. Really nice to me because I'm a white person and that's, you know, so it is. But he was extremely racist and extremely bigoted, and he would always talk about the judicial system. And he would wipe his ass with $1 bills. He had a stack of $1 bills that he would wipe his ass with because it was a promissory note, not actual legal tender. These are the people that we grew up around. And then we had this other guy named Roger that lived on a sailboat year-round. And there's pretty hard winters there. Tiny little sailboat. And the way he spoke and the way he moved didn't make sense. He was just a little, like, 5 foot, 2 inches tall guy. And he had this, like, weird... And he moved with these really quick movements. And he liked to dance. And he would dance around on the boat dock and stuff. And he would go around and climb everyone else's sailboats and replace all the stuff, but he would have little dance parties by himself outside of a sailboat, and there's just so many people that when you start just writing them all down, they don't make sense. But that's that weird micro kind of cosms you get that you get out in the middle of nowhere, because they're so cut off from the rest of the world that they create their own little universe that exists outside of stuff. It's interesting. Lots of fucked up, weird people. And then I saw some really fucked up stuff, too. You have some skeletons in your closet, too. Care to share? I really don't, Nesgar. I share everything. I was always really fortunate to have really good parents that kind of kept me, like... I just saw a lot of fucked up stuff. Lots, like I said, lots of drunk people flying off cliffs and shit when they drive... Yeah, basically I grew up in Twin Peaks, but I thought it was normal. I didn't understand that it was weird and that these people were unique because it was all I knew. So it was just another day in the life, you know? Like that guy, you know, like the guy that, the sanitary napkins guy or whatever, you know? Like, he was a character and he was extremely redneck, but deep down he had a really big heart, you know? And like, there's people like that that, like, they might not be intelligent. They might be kind of ignorant when it comes to how they see the rest of the world. But it's just because they're unexperienced to it. You know, I always remember, like, a good sign of that guy's character was there was this girl that he was, and he was fun. He was like 5'3", really tiny guy with hair that was in ponytails. All, like, he had it, like, scrunched off, like, 10 different times, all the way down past his ass. And, you know, he had, like, 10 cars in his yard, typical Arkansas kind of situation. And this girl he was seeing at the time got pregnant. Everyone knew it wasn't his. Fucking everyone. And this girl's also twice as big as her. She's like 6'4" and huge, and it's always pretty comical. But everyone knew, but no one said anything. And then when the baby was born, everyone especially knew. It looked exactly like one of his best friends, who also lives in the same trailer park. He never said anything. Kid gets to 5 years old. Mom packs up and leaves. He continues raising the kid. Never says anything. Kid now is like 10. Looks exactly like that guy. Never says anything. And that is his son. And it's like one of those things. It's like deep down he knows. but it's easier for him just to never say it out loud. And he might be ignorant, and he might be kind of, you know, he doesn't realize all the ways that he's ignorant, but a good sign of his character is that he just sticks with it, like that. And it's like those little things, like you meet those people, and it's like at first glance, you're like, whoa, you're fucking weird, and you're fucked up. But then you see these little things that they do and how they help each other out, and it's unique and it's impressive. Let's see. Alright, so then let me check Discord again for questions. Snowy Noe wants to know if there's any shows that you're chopping block or even just getting a little overhaul, like adding Dan to LAN Party. And can you read your shirt for me? No, I'm not going to read it for you. As far as chopping block, okay, so here's an idea that we've been throwing around, guys. This, we've realized that a lot of our 1 p.m. shows don't do very well. And we honestly thought when we started this channel we would have more midday viewers, because some people can track midday pretty well. We don't. The other problem is the noise issue. So like, say, Goob's show. We're honestly having a discussion with Goobs about trying to do his show at 10 p.m. after Vanquished. Because then he can be as loud as he wants, and we don't have to put a leash on Goobers. Because that sucks for us, and it sucks for him, and it sucks for the neighbors next door when we try to do that midday. So there's been discussions about us moving our schedule around a little bit to do like 4 p.m. to late. You know? Bafana72 says, how did you go from the boat docks to doing things like Geek and Sundry and now Hyper RPG? Okay, honestly, I think the correlation is pretty strong, Bafana. So that boat dock, what it allowed me to do was fucking tell stories with these old fishermen every day. So from a really young age, I was sat... Okay, so when you go to this boat dock, you walk down it, and there's like an old wood bench that just overlooks the lake right next to the main room there. And I had to have the coffee ready at 7 a.m. every morning. So at 7 a.m., I'd have that coffee ready, and for the first hour and a half of my job, it was always 60-year-old and up men sitting on that bench with us and just talking and having a conversation. And that was my life from the age of like 12 up to when I went to college. Those were my friends. I didn't have friends in high school. I was weird. I was an art kid. I was this, that. I was too weird because I had to go to school 30 miles away in a different town. And the life I lived in the boat dock was so different from the cowboy kind of farmer life of the people I went to school with. So the only people I related to were these old people that I'd sit and share stories with. And sharing those stories and got me into movies. The other thing was because I lived out in the middle of nowhere, and I know I've told this story many times, is we didn't have TV where I grew up, really, because we were too far out in the middle of nowhere. So we had a guy up in St. Louis that would bring us every weekend a tape with 3 recorded movies from HBO on it. So all I did was watch movies. So that was my language, was film and stories with these old men and stuff. And that led me kind of to painting. And also growing up on the lake led me to painting. Because that, I don't know, being surrounded by that scenery, it was very picturesque. There was, actually, I don't know what led to it. I don't know. Fuck! Really? Shit! Welcome and thank you for subscribing. Very much appreciated. Thank you for that subscription. Woo! Okay. So, thank you, Tybo Arrow, for that follow. Very much appreciated. No, I did not play D&D or RPGs growing up because I lived out in the middle of fucking nowhere. I had no friends. It was my brothers and I. But what we did is played the fuck out of some make-believe. You better believe it. We did a lot of make-believe. Lots and lots and lots. So, and we had no context for what was cool and what was not. So even at the age of 14, my other people that I went to school with that lived a long ways away, because we were on the lake in the woods, was a very long ways away from where I went to high school, because my mom taught there. And it was the closest one, but it was like 30 minutes away. What's up, Billy Bob Frog? And my sister, who's not my real sister, but she's the only other kid in the area, so we got raised together, and my brothers and I, we were playing like X-Men in the yard until we were 15 and 16, fighting imaginary bad guys. Because we didn't know. We didn't know that other people were cool and we were uncool. We were isolated, I guess is the right word. And I watched a lot of movies, so my imagination went pretty nuts. So I never got to do that kind of stuff, but I read the fuck out of comic books. I would buy backlogs at Walmart back in the day. So we would go to Walmart once a week on the weekend. I would also, so not only did I get those tapes with three in it, when I got old enough to get my first like video kind of card at a rental place, which I think I got my first one when I was 12 actually, because I got my job. Yeah, I got my job and I didn't have money to do the card. So we would go to Mountain Home, Arkansas. And there was this place that was 7 videotapes for 7 days for $7. And I could afford that because I had a fucking job. So we would go once a week to that town. I was usually on a Saturday. I'd get the 7 movies, usually horror movies, and they fucked me up pretty bad. Then we'd go to Walmart and I'd pick up, with a little bit extra cash, the double packs that they would sell at Walmart of back issues of comic books. So it was usually X-Men, Spider-Man, New Warriors, X-Factor, X-Men 2099, Spider-Man 29, stuff like that. So, I got really big into comic books, and that was kind of my nerd kind of thing. I lived in Arkansas, so Walmarts were like, you fucking throw a rock. I was out in the middle of nowhere. If you want to see where that boat dock is located, you can type on Google Maps, Pontiac, Missouri. There'll be pictures. A lot of those pictures that are going to come up are probably from my mom. Actually, now I'm curious. I'm going to Google. My mom's a practicing photographer, so I bet if I search, I'm curious now, if I search how many of her pictures come up. It depends on how good she is at geotagging her pictures, which she's probably not, because she doesn't know what geotagging means. So let's see what comes up. Let's see here. Images. Oh, very first one is a picture my mom took, and it's not a good one. That's hilarious. That's probably Google though doing its job. That's really funny. Jeez. I figured more of hers would show up though. Oh, there's a couple more. Now I'm seeing them. Mixed in with the Pontiac cars, of course. That's funny. Ecstasy Camel. Thank you for that follow. Oh yeah, wow, yeah, right on the border. Well, we had land in Missouri and Arkansas, so we actually were kind of like both. And my dad worked in Arkansas, and my mom worked in Missouri. Pontiac Cove Marina, that's the one. It's not nice to laugh at your mom's head. Alright. Yep, Pontiac Cove. But yeah, I could share stories about that place forever. And Lucas and my other brother, we all laughed there, or lived there, laughed there. I read it and I said it. It means I'm getting tired. It was a great, great experience to grow up in that kind of environment, shielded from the rest of the world. And what I mean by shielded is like, my parents are really good at teaching us not, oh, fuck, really? 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 They sell straight out of 65729 shirts? Are you fucking kidding me? Are you kidding me? Oh my god. Alright. That is a funny thing. Because in the winter, it's a town of about 50 or less people. When I was growing up, it was 30. In the summer, maybe it gets up to 300 because of all the summer homes on the lake. Maybe. Can you finish the story of how you ended up a Geek and Sundry Now Hyper-RPG? Okay, Bafana, Bafana 72. I'm sorry I'm getting off track. So, basically, all that storytelling led me to painting. Because as much as I loved film, where I lived without having access, like the place I went to high school in, they didn't have a camera for video things or anything like that, but we did have an art class. And it was art was a form of storytelling. So I got into it. And I was a good writer because I'm dyslexic and my brain doesn't work that way. I've always been a very visual person. Oh man, one of the stories I could tell you, but that would get me way off track, is when I was 5, how I ran away. Not really running away, but told my parents I was going to go to a waterfall they pointed at. Fucking shit, son of a bitch! Thank you guys, very much appreciated. Okay, whoo, thank you for that subscription. Dance, Whitey, dance. Yeah, thank you. Yeah. The new cardio workout slot, right? Totally, yeah, definitely. Okay, so, all right. So I've always had a visual memory. If I went somewhere once, I could go there again, because I based my memory on visual cues, blah, 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 and even at a young age, I would walk through the woods alone, up to miles away, and my parents would think I ran away, and they'd have to go find me, and it was a big thing, but I was never lost. I knew where I was. Okay, so, fuck. Back to that. So I took art in high school because there was no other form of storytelling that I could do other than that. And I didn't even think film was anything that was accomplishable if you weren't born into it, because that's all I knew about it. And it wasn't until I got to college for art that my roommate at the time, I'm still really good friends with, and he lives in LA, was like, do you want to join the film club with me? I was like, really? There's a film club here? How do people afford that? And he was like, dude, there's digital cameras and stuff, and the school has some that you can use. I was like, are you fucking kidding me? And it freaked me out, because I just never imagined that that was something accomplishable, because I was just so enamored by film. So then I joined the film club, and we started making stuff. And then I stole 2 cameras from Walmart in 2003, and was pretty sleuthy about it, but we won't go into those stories, that'll get us off track. I started making films, and I started entering film competitions. And once I got into it, I started researching how to do the editing and kind of became my own teacher on that. Because if there's one thing that growing up in Missouri and Arkansas taught me, it was how to figure shit out. That you have to be resourceful to survive. So, that's always been really good for doing these kinds of things. Because you need to know how to learn skills quickly by just figuring it out. Statute of limitations is probably expired. I entered a couple film competitions and won some awards, and then I decided when I graduated with my undergrad, I was going to go get my master's in painting, which I did, but while I was there, I was using that as a primer to study film, because my goal was when I graduated with my master's in Kansas City that I was going to move to LA to pursue film. So I spent that time while I was doing my master's in painting, also giving myself kind of a master's class on film, camera techniques, editing, lighting, all those kinds of things. I shot a lot of music videos and shit while I was there. I didn't do much film. And then I went to LA. I started off in LA by doing a pilot and a series about clowns. It won a couple pilot awards, it didn't get picked up. Then I started doing independent film, DP'd a bunch of stuff. Director of photography, for those that don't know. And then I started a production company. At my production company, we started producing some pilots and got into the comedy scene. I did a lot of comedy videos and got to work with some really amazing people. And through that, I met Felicia. Actually, I met Felicia first at an internship I had in LA that I was only there for 2 weeks and I quit because they asked me to get them coffee and I said, fuck you, and I was out. But I met Felicia first there, but then I met her again when Geek and Sundry picked up the pilot that my production company was making. And I met her through that and took that opportunity to pitch to her my idea for Twitch. She really loved it. And I liked what she wanted to do with Twitch. Crash 616, thank you for following. At that time, I had already been working on Socialtron Live with Greg Grunberg, which those guys went on to make The Attack. But while I was there, I started looking at what you could do with Twitch, taking a lot of notes. They didn't really have the audience that I liked, and thought, oh man, Felicia's got the perfect audience for what I want to do with Twitch. There's all these opportunities to tell stories interactively with a really, but you can only do that with a positive community. You can only fucking do that with a positive community. If you have a community of trolls and dickheads, you can't do the kind of storytelling that we do on this channel. You just can't. You are on a lot of people's CVs as director a whole bunch. Came across that while looking for the clown thing. What do you mean CVs? I don't know what that is. But anyway, I went for that, and then Geek and Sundry, based on the kind of pitch that I had made. And then always kind of wanted to take that further and hit roadblocks, and now we're here. All right. But not because of Felicia, I can tell you that. I think Felicia's amazing. I honestly mean it. Everybody, like, yeah. There's so many people that I think are amazing, and it's unfortunate. Okay. Let's see. To help clarify, referring to shirt ideas, I'm suggesting by the merch store. With the merch store that just started, start right off with Thumper suggested content, or do Hyper RPG have any additional merch ideas first? Merch store first, Prosperous Guard, will be stuff that we've already created. Hey, Fret Noise, thank you for that follow. Very much appreciated. Alright, guys, this is going to be the last round of questions, and I've got to go home. I got a Circulum Vitae School of Life. Interesting. So you mean resume. Gotcha. Blah, blah, blah. Star Wars RPG, can we have a weekly subscriber NPC like in Vanquished? I don't know. We're a long way off, Setsar off, so I can't tell you anything about that. That's a long way off. It takes a long time to plan these things, especially to find talent. How do you, Bob asks, how do you go about keeping smaller tasks in front of you when working on a very large number of things? Often with the number of tasks I'm working on, I only remember the small things after it's too late. I do that all the time, Bob. Rai use post-it notes. I use Windows Sticky and emails to myself. I email myself all the time. That's what I do. I email myself all the time. And I put little sticky notes on the side of my computer so I don't forget the small stuff. I'm also just really used to multitasking. I've been doing it for a while now, so my brain's gotten used to having to think of all the other things going on at once. Except when I'm reading three different chat rooms. That's when it gets frustrating. Zach, have you thought of different VR painting apps like the VR spray software? I can't find it, Negi. Have you found it yet? Because I didn't think it released yet. If it did, I want to try it. Krillin asks, have you ever thought about talking to Twitch about their god-awful subscription system, which makes it really hard on subs by lacking any kind of regularity on subscription renewals? No, I haven't really talked about that, Krillin, because that doesn't seem to be a conversation that comes up too much. I guess I would need more detail on why you think it's bad. HyperRPG, how about replacing Colony News with a short role-playing with opposition forces to build storylines and know who we're fighting? I'd be interested in doing that, Lemire, if we lost front page support. That's something to discuss if we lost front page. The reason we do Corporate Sins or Colony News where we do it right now and the way we do it is because we have rotation at a terrible time for that show. We have rotation before the battle begins. And it's really important for us to try to retain people before the battle's up. So, it's tough. Alienator said, I had a friend over on Sunday and I had the rebroadcast on in the background while we hung out. I don't talk to them that often, but he's a nice guy. However, he was making comments that day that, had he been in chat, I probably would have banned him. And talking to him, I honestly don't think he even knew what he did wrong. He was a very 1950s white guy, nice mentality. He'll give the shirt off his back, but say horrible things while doing it. Honestly, I'm not sure how to deal with that, but it sounds like some of the people you grew up with, so any suggestions? Yes. Okay. Most of my life was spent around people like this alien knitter, and it is unfortunate. But what I try to say is remember perspective. And it's funny because I felt like, when I was in college, I went through a stage where I just got mad at them. Like, it always made me uncomfortable when I was younger. But then when I went to college and I got to be surrounded by the opposite end of the spectrum, where everyone was extremely the opposite end of, like, political correctness, I came back home and I was just really angry. And then I went through another shift where I kind of realized, like, okay, angry is not helpful. It's not helpful at all. They're just ignorant. And ignorance is different than hate. And it's good to be able to distinguish the two. Because a lot of people, when they're made aware that they're being ignorant, will change a little bit. They'll be defensive at first, because it's always hard for someone to hear that they might have hurt someone else. Always. That's not something anyone's good at dealing with, because it takes personal accountability, which is a very mature thing to do. But it takes time, and usually you can bring people around. So a lot of people I grew up with, it's like that perspective, like you said, of knowing some of the nicest people I've ever met that would literally just stop everything they're doing to help you if you happen to be white and Christian. Does that mean that they would never help a black person? No. Does it mean that they would never help, say, a gay person? No. It means that they've never had the opportunity to do so, and when the opportunity presents itself, they have years and years and years of things that they've been lied to about and has been fed into their fucking egos that they don't fully understand, and they react based on instinct rather than experience. And when people try to say racism's based on experience, I think that's fucking bullshit. Everyone goes through shit. And if it was all based on experience, you'd be just as hateful towards the people that are standing right next to you as you would anyone else. Because especially if you grew up where I grew up, most of the people who do shitty things to you are the people of your own race. Most definitely. Because that's what you're around. You're surrounded by other poor white people. So I think it's just, it's ignorance. And, my brothers and I all, especially my middle brother and I, just took it upon ourselves to just be good people and say, fuck you and do otherwise. And my middle brother's gay, but he's the most manly of the three brothers. Like, he's literally a man's man in so many ways. And he's the one everyone likes back home. They don't like me. I challenge them. I'm an artist, and I'm weird, and I think differently than them. They fucking hate it. But he is just like them. He's a beard. He works at a brewery. He's a baseball player, but he's gay. And he challenges them in ways that is amazing to see, because the ones that accept it, you see changes in them. And the internet's helped change things a lot too, but there's a lot of people that just don't know. So it's good to be able to differentiate between hate and ignorance, because ignorance you can change because you can educate, but hate, it's a whole other fucking thing to deal with. And I don't have advice for that. But you know, chat rooms are different because you just have to assume. Yeah, they might only be ignorant, but you have to create a safe space for others, so you just have to know. You can get that anywhere else, and it's no. But in real-life conversations, it is different. Because you have to look through the comments and say, okay, what are they really saying? I don't like it when other people just jump down someone else's throat, especially in a public space, and say, oh, you can't say that. And it's like, well, for one, who are you to say that they can't? A better thing would be like, let's have a conversation. Let's talk. I might be that person that you're actually insulting, and you don't even know it. Maybe not do that. And sometimes there can be a change in them, so. Silly Sunny, I'm usually in the same boat as you, but then I'm kind of the other way, too. I have belief and faith in that everyone is equally as shitty and as good, and that has nothing to do with race or anything else. It has to do with just people. People are people. And anyone can shape their experiences, good or bad, towards what makes them better. And some people have to overcome a lot more to do it. And I think that's a good sign of character when they do so. My window shows the same. Without you here, the seasons pass me by. Are there any more things in there? I would never play fantasy football, there's no way. What is this Joker shirt? What is this thing you posted? I'm looking at it right now. I'm pulling it up. What? Today has been okay. So somebody made this? What one person did that? Who? Never mind, I know who. Fuck, I know exactly who did it. Oh my god, that's amazing. Because we used to listen to Eazy-E nonstop. And this is exactly the kind of thing he would do. We used to listen to Eazy-E all the time. Yeah, I know exactly who made that. That's so funny. Alright. Okay. PK Theater, so I actually, I grew up around a KKK group and a terrorist organization that was bad news, and that was, I did. I'll look into all that stuff, guys, but, I was fine, SCO, I was great. Okay, guys, I think I need to shut it down. It's getting late, and I still gotta get some downloads ready for tomorrow. It's D&D without MRG. Alright guys, so I hope you had fun on Sierra Night. I hope we answered some questions for you. Thank you all for tuning in. Thank you for that sub drive. It means the world to us. Please stick around, watch the shows, help us make them better. We want to make the Twitch that you want to see. Like, ideally, that's what I want from this. Like I said, I literally took a year of fucking feedback. Oh, thank you, Battle Looker. I literally took a year of feedback from people on what they said they wanted to see, so we're trying to do our best to do that. So if you have feedback that's constructive, I hear all the negative we get from Paige. I hear it. But if it's constructive and there's things you want to see, let us know and we'll do everything we can to make it work. Stone Terror, we did audio podcasts for a month and nobody listened to them, so we stopped doing them because it was extra work. So who are we raiding tonight? Who do you guys want to raid? Fuck! Really?
Subscriber.
Thank you for that one right at the end there. Thanks for that. All right. That was four. All right. Who are we raiding tonight, guys? Who are we raiding? Is Bronze Girl still streaming? Because we'll throw her a raid. We'll raid her real good. All right. I'm looking for names, guys. Tell me who you want me to raid. She's offline. Oh, Bronze is up. Bronze is still up. All right, guys. So we're going to raid Bronze Girl. We're gonna raid Bronze Girl. Alright. You guys ready? Wait, no, Bronze is asleep? Bronze is up? Who's saying all this stuff? Okay, who do I believe here? Because you're saying Bronze is asleep, but Morag is up. Who's actually up, guys? Actually, you know what? If Morag is up, we should raid Morag. We should raid Morag. Okay, never mind. You already posted that, Bronze Girl. No, now you're going to probably post it again. Blah, 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 blah. Blah, 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 blah. 30-second lag. Really great. So much fun. Actually, we raided Bronze twice last week. So we're going to do Morag. We're going to raid Morag, guys. So throw the Morag command up in chat and get Morag's channel up. Alright, Alienator, we're gonna do Morag. Tay Morag, guys. He's great. He's a lot of fun. We only pretend that we hate each other. He's a really great dude. He's actually a really great dude. Alright, there we go. There's that command. Alright, guys. Are you ready? Alright? Are you ready? You have to start it, because I'm here. I can't start it. So you have to start it. Alright? In 3, 2, 1, get out of here! Get over there! Go raid that motherfucker and tell him I sent you! I'm out!